Hi, welcome to a new installment of Look and Listen, our monthly online exploration of the intersections between Asian art and music. I'm Deborah Diamond, curator of South and Southeast Asian art at the Freer and Sackler Galleries, the Smithsonian's National Museum of Asian Art, and I'm joined today by Jayanthi Sahasrabhuthe, a wonderful vocalist in the Indian classical music tradition. One of the leading disciples of the great Veena Sahasrabhuthe, with whom she performed many concerts, including a memorable one at the Freer back in 2000, Jayanthi performs and teaches in the San Francisco Bay Area, from where she joins us today. While our other Look and Listens have focused on instruments, I turn to Jayanthi because the Indian classical tradition values the voice above all. Indeed, the voice is so cherished for its expressiveness that all other instruments seek to emulate its range and subtlety. Together, Jayanthi and I will explore a quintessentially Indian mood, one associated with the annual season of rains that drench the Indian subcontinent between, this is roughly if all goes well, May and September. The emotions engendered by those life-giving rains and their sensuous pleasures are overwhelmingly positive. As a native New Yorker, I still remember how many years ago I was startled to learn this. Rather than my experience of thunderstorms as annoying or worse, the Indian monsoon is not only beloved, it also evokes the emotions of love and longing. Jayanthi, who was born in Mumbai, then called Bombay, will tell us about the monsoon from her perspective, and then throughout the program will unfold how the monsoon has inspired music, poetry, and painting.
Thank you, Deborah. Namaste. Thank you to the Smithsonian Museum for inviting me today. It's a pleasure to sing for the Look and Listen series, and especially the one on the monsoon and the rains. Growing up in India, I've always looked forward to the monsoons every year. And it's not just me, it's the entire Indian subcontinent that awaits the rains after a dry, hot, parched summer. Monsoon turns the land 1,000 shades of green, makes man and nature dance. Over 1 billion people are jubilant. The mountains, the rivers, the wildlife, all of nature, all of creation is in raptures. The monsoon rains, they bring joy, they bring relief, and they bring life. That's why Indian poetry, literature, art, theater, dance, music are all filled with references to the monsoon. I'm happy to bring you Indian classical music compositions today in the family of rags related to the monsoons. And these convey the joyous emotions of the monsoons.
Thank you, Jayanthi. I want to begin with a small portrait, an image of a prince on a rainy monsoon night. The joyous emotions of which Jayanthi just spoke are the context in which this portrait was understood. Painted circa 1695 in southern Rajasthan, in a place just outside the city of Udaipur. It depicts a young prince in the countryside beneath a night sky brimming with water-soaked clouds. He seems to have been caught unawares because he's tucked his sword tightly under one arm in order to clutch a thin cotton wrap, now drenched and transparent, around his shoulders. Raindrops ping off the shield he wears as a rain hat, and rivulets of water swirl beneath his feet. It's a small painting. It's only about 8 inches high, and it was made to be held in the hand and viewed from an intimate distance so that its details could be savored. Notice the rich saturated hues, the glimmer of the sword's gold hilt just peeking out from under the prince's arm, the luminous quality of his skin, and the surprising blue color of his eyes. This portrait and the other paintings we'll view today are opaque watercolors on paper, with many of their pigments made from ground semi-precious minerals or pure gold. If there are any European portraits of rulers in the rain, they are indeed very rare. In contrast, this portrait of a prince speaks to the embodied experience of the monsoon and its sensuous pleasures. Rajasthan is brutally hot and dry before the monsoon, so this prince is enjoying the coolness of the rains on his skin, savoring the smell of dry earth suddenly drenched, and he'd also be experiencing a particular soundscape, the rumble of thunder and the cries of monsoon birds like peacocks and hawk cuckoos. So what inspired a painter from Rajasthan to depict a prince in a monsoon downpour? And what emotions would viewers have brought to this painting? For answers, let's listen to Jayanti.
Thank you, Deborah. I love how this painting conveys the beautiful experience of the monsoons. Today I will be singing three different rags of the Malhar group of rags. Rag is a set of rules and musical phrases to create melodies. Different rags have different moods. Some rags are associated with specific seasons. Malhar is a family of rags associated with the monsoons. The first rag I will sing is Rag Gaud Malhar. Just as in Western classical music, we have the notes Do, Re, Mi, so also in Indian classical music, we have the notes Sa, Re, Ga, Ma, and so on. The phrase Mare, Pa is a very distinctive phrase of Malhar group of rags. The meend is like a glide from one note to another. So as in Mare, Pa, that's a very distinctive phrase of Rag Malhar. In an actual concert, I would have a tabla player and a harmonium or sarangi player to accompany me. But today I will use my electronic tabla to accompany me. I will first sing typical phrases of Rag Gaud Malhar, followed by an alap, and then a composition set to a 16-beat rhythmic cycle known as Teen Taal. The lyrics of this composition are about the dusky monsoon clouds and about Krishna. The translation will be on the screen, but let me give you a sense of the sound in a dialect of Hindi. Savari badariya aire, bole ban me papiha, savari surat mohan ki, Savari badariya savan ki, in do mila mora man harlino, Savari badariya aire.
Sa sa re ga re ga ma, re re pa da pa da ga pa ma, ma pa. Badani sa dhani pa da pa da ga pa ma ga re ga sa re रे रे रे
Oh, Jayanti, that was beautiful. It inspired me to share this painting from the court at Chamba, which was a kingdom in Himachal Pradesh in the foothills of the Himalayas. It was painted around 1795, 100 years after the portrait we viewed earlier. Jayanti sang of dusky clouds, the dusky face of the Hindu god Krishna, and how together they will steal one's heart. This painting, depicting dusky Krishna between huge dark clouds, was meant to be captivating in the same way. By the 17th century, a form of Hindu devotionalism in which a personal relationship with Krishna was paramount had swept across all of North India. And one way of connecting with Krishna was feeling passionate love. His most archetypal devotees, here shown clustering around Krishna, are gopis, women from a cowherder's village who love God without reservation. You might ask, so why is it stormy? Well, we've already spoken of how the rains almost miraculously and very pleasantly transform the climate. It's also traditionally the season when military campaigns were halted and trade networks were shut down so that soldiers and merchants could race home before the roads became impassable. With the men at home, it became the season of romance.
Thank you, Deborah. Now I will sing a composition in Raag Mia Malhar. When I was learning this Raag for the very first time from my guru, she told me to imagine dark, dense rain clouds wrestling with each other and coming down on earth as blissful, life-giving rain. You will notice that the melodies in Raag Mia Malhar have many twists and turns, as if clouds wrestling with each other. I will first sing the Aroha Avroha, also the known as the ascending and descending scale of Raag Mia Malhar, followed by an Alap, and then a composition set to a 16-beat cycle known as Adha. This kind of composition is called Tarana. This particular Tarana is composed by Pandit Kashinath Bodas. And Tarana is a kind of composition that uses syllables instead of song lyrics for its text.
Sabare pa ma bani dhani sa sa dani pa ne ma ma pa ga ma re sa.
Tare, dani, tanana, tom, tare.
atatana derena atatana derena atatana derena ri.
Thank you, Jayanti. The abstract nature of the syllables you just sang in the Tarana makes me think of the way that painters did clouds in Indian monsoon paintings. North Indian court painters overwhelmingly favored opaque watercolors that were smoothly and painstakingly applied within crisp contours. But when they painted clouds, they allowed for spontaneity and chance by diluting the pigments with water. In the visual equivalent of onomatopoeia, the material quality of rainwater imbues their clouds. So we return to our painting of the prince. To create the clouds, the artist poured on silvery grays and inky blues, turning the paper this way and that way to let the pigments puddle variously on the paper surface. And he delighted in how water pours and sprays from the wet bursting clouds, flicking and dabbing his brush to mimic rain that pours furiously from the sky, bounces off the hat of the prince, drips down from his cape, and puddles on the ground.
Thank you, Deborah. For the last musical item of our program, I will sing compositions in Raag Megh Malhar. These compositions convey the monsoon moods very beautifully. Before I begin, let me tell you about the instrument that I'm playing while singing. This instrument is called the Tanpura. I play the strings of this instrument in a loop, and this creates a rich and beautiful background sound, inviting me to paint melodies in the canvas of the rag. My guru taught me that singing is akin to painting a picture using music. I will sing introductory alap in rag Megh Malhar. Introductory alaps create the mood of the rag, followed by a short composition in Ek Taal of 12 beats, and finally a composition in Adha Chautal of 14 beats.
The verses that Jayanti will next sing convey the emotions of a young woman alone at night with dark thundering clouds. Significantly, it's the onset of the monsoon, and our heroine is scared that her distant beloved won't be able to come home. This painting, circa 1700 and from Udaipur in southern Rajasthan, also depicts a young woman on a monsoon night. But her yearning for her beloved is so great that she leaves her home and braves the dangers of dark thundering clouds and crackling lightning. Once again, we can enjoy how the artist played with the clouds, creating atmosphere and wetness by smooching together watery lavenders, grays, and bright blotches of smalt blue, a pigment made from ground glass. The red and gold snaky sizzles are lightning running across the sky. The painting illustrates a verse by the great poet Keshav Das, describing a particular type of heroine, the Apisarika Nayaka, the one whose love makes her fearless. Indeed, she is so focused on love, the poet tells us, that she has the concentration of a yogi. So she doesn't notice that snakes are coiling around her ankles, or that wild animals and fire-breathing monsters lie ahead. The painter, whose name sadly is lost to history, has placed our heroine at the bottom right corner of the paper and her lover at the top left in order to emphasize that her route is long and arduous. Her lover waits calmly and patiently in the marble pavilion. Blue-skinned and with a yellow garment, he is the lovely god Krishna, and she therefore is Radha, the village gopi who was his special beloved. Together, they are the quintessential lovers of bhakti devotion. In the painting, Krishna is wearing his characteristic yellow dhoti beneath a princely robe. So he's here depicted as a prince, and Radha, in a gold skirt, is dressed as a Rajput princess. So our lovers are simultaneously heroine and hero, princess and prince, and Radha and Krishna, during the monsoon, that most romantic of seasons. You might be wondering why the paintings we're viewing today, feature so much about mood and emotion, feature characters, princes, gods, and gopis, who show very little emotion on their faces. That's probably because Indian aesthetic experience is focused on the emotion felt by the viewer, not the emotion of the character on the stage or in a painting. So connoisseurs viewing these paintings or listening to these compositions would recognize monsoon motifs from life, poetry, music, or paintings, as those are all intertwined. Thus, seeing or hearing and remembering dense clouds, spiky lightning, the feel of rain on your skin, the smell of wet earth, the cries of monsoon birds, these would all trigger feelings of joy, love, and longing.
Ah, 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 ah.
Thank you, Jayanti. That composition was moving. It's said that a perfectly performed raga can affect change in the world, and that the Malhar ragas can make it rain. So if that holds true even virtually over Zoom and YouTube, you can all expect some precipitation quite shortly. In the meantime, I want to thank you all for coming to our Look and Listen. I hope you enjoyed this musical journey. I'm Deborah Diamond, signing off and wishing you health and happiness until our next program.